Our study on this program brings us to the fifth chapter of the Gospel of John. I'm reading from verse 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after troubling of the water, stepped in and was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is it which said unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed knew not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. We find here in John's Gospel the third public miracle of the Lord Jesus Christ as recorded by the writer John. Just briefly, we remember that John records seven miracles in the public ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, and by giving us those seven miracles presents to us a profile or a portrait of who the Lord Jesus Christ is, with the express purpose, as he says in the end of his gospel, These are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, and that believing you might have life in his name. So John selects these miracles, and we're seeing these as we study the Gospel of John. This is the third miracle as recorded in John's Gospel. We find that near this pool of Bethesda, there were a great multitude of people. There was a great multitude of people. It's interesting to note as we move down through this chapter that out of all of that multitude of people, only one was healed. I believe that there's a very important principle that we see here. We certainly find that God has the ability to heal from physical ailments or diseases. And yet, we see the Lord Jesus moving among that throng of people. Some were blind, some were crippled, and they had infirmities of different sorts. And yet, he chooses just one individual out of all of that crowd. We might ask ourselves, why didn't he heal the rest of them? Why just this one individual? As I said, there is an important principle for us to see here. God is able to heal, and yet God does not always heal each and every individual. Remember also that these signs are given to present to us who Christ is and what he came to do. When the Lord Jesus performed miracles of healings during his earthly ministry, they illustrate to us, and illustrated even in that day, spiritual truths. When we see him healing a man that's born blind, we understand from the Bible that he is able to give us sight as well, for the Bible says that outside of Christ, we are spiritually blind. When we see the Lord Jesus raising an individual from the dead, we understand that he is able to give us life as well, for the Bible declares that outside of Christ, we are dead and separated from God. And so when we see the Lord Jesus giving strength to this impotent man who hadn't walked, had this infirmity for 38 years, was not able to get himself down into the healing waters of this pool. Why, we are reminded of the scripture that tells us in Romans 5:6, "For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly." We were without strength, without ability to help ourselves. As far as salvation is concerned, the Lord Jesus Christ came into the world and died for us to give us the ability to walk before God in the way that He would have us to do. We note also that this man had this infirmity 38 years. Now, why would the scripture note such a seemingly insignificant detail? Or is it insignificant? Why, certainly it wasn't insignificant to this man who had had this disease that long, but why 38 years? Remember that in the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 2 and verse 14, we have a fact recorded there for us. That is this, that the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness from Kadesh Barnea, the place where they rebelled against God, and God told them that they must wander in the wilderness for the remainder of those years until the generation died off. They wandered for 38 years. They were in the wilderness for 40 years, but their wanderings were for 38 years. I believe we have another picture here. As we have said, a type, which is a picture that illustrates to us a spiritual truth. 38 years is a number that would have been highly significant to the Jews living in the day of the Lord Jesus. It's a number that spoke of their rebellion and of their disobedience and of their rejection and murmuring against God. And I believe here the Lord Jesus was pointing out that fact through this healing of this man that we see who had the infirmity for 38 years. The scripture is recording it that we might take heed to these things. Now the Lord Jesus asked an interesting question. At first it might seem to sort of puzzle us. He says, as he sees the man laying there, "Wilt thou be made whole?" Why, imagine if you were in that position and the Lord asked you, "Do you want to be made whole?" Why, of course you would want to be made whole. Why would the Lord ever ask such a question? But I believe that there is a reason. In light of what's said in verse 14, when the Lord Jesus heals this man and the man comes and finds him, the Lord tells him, "Go and sin no more." It's very possible that this individual was in the condition that he was in because of some sin in his life. Now, that's not always the reason for physical ailments, but it can be the reason for sickness or for infirmity. And the Lord tells him, "Go and sin no more." It's very likely that he was in his position or condition because of some sin that was in his life. Other than this, we note that the Lord uses this probing question, "Do you want to be made whole? What do you desire to have happen to you?" That's the question that I would ask you today. Do you want to be made whole? Not necessarily of your physical ailment, but do you want to find the healing that comes through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? What is it that's troubling your life? What is the spiritual infirmity that is crippling you? Is it drugs? Is it alcohol? Is it some other vice? What is it that is crippling you? Problem in your marriage? Problem in your finances? I'm not here today to tell you that Jesus Christ is a cure-all for every little ill that man experiences. But I am here to tell you this. If you have a spiritual need in your life, if you recognize that something is missing from your life and that something is the fact that you're not right with God, you can find in the Lord Jesus complete deliverance from sin and wholeness and soundness of body and mind, spiritual well-being, if you will come to Him and place your faith and trust in Him, the one who died on the cross to provide a means of salvation for you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ this very moment and receive the life-giving power that is found through faith in him. You notice that this man answers the Lord Jesus and he says, "No, I have no man. Nobody to help me down into the pool. Nobody to help me into the healing waters there so that I might be made well. And every time I attempt, someone else gets in before me and is healed. No man. No one found that could help him." Oh, I want to tell you that we see this man's helplessness, and there was a recognition of this on his part. Nobody can help me into the pool. And then we see also the recognition of his need of a mediator, someone that would help him. The Lord Jesus is that someone. The Lord Jesus is the one who gives the power and enablement. Oh, have you recognized that you don't have any man on earth who can help you spiritually speaking? No one can give you the kind of relationship with God that you need. No rabbi, no priest, no pope can take you to heaven. Only the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the one mediator, the scripture says, between God and man. You notice the Lord Jesus commands him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." What power is seen in the word of the Lord Jesus Christ? Omnipotent power to command an individual, 38 years infirm, to take up your bed and walk. And faith was needed on the part of that man. Imagine if you were crippled and lying there, or unable to walk and lying there, and someone told you to get up and walk. Why, you could just continue to lie there, couldn't you? And say, "Well, you know, I can't walk anyway. What's the point?" But it took faith on that man's part, faith in what the Lord Jesus said, faith in the Word of God, for him to rise and take up his bed and walk. When this occurs, the Pharisees meet this individual. The scripture is careful to note that it's the Sabbath, and they become incensed. They become angry and say, "What are you doing carrying your bed? It's not lawful for you to walk." They didn't seem to care that this man had just been healed after not having been able to walk for 38 years. They were concerned about what they interpreted the law to read. And so they ask him. We see their response to this miracle. When they found out that it was Jesus that had made this man whole, they sought the more to persecute the Lord Jesus and to slay him because he had done this on the Sabbath day. We see the statement of the Lord Jesus as he confronts them. Jesus answered and says, "My Father works hitherto and I work." What did he mean by that? Well, why don't we let the Jews of the day of the Lord Jesus, who understood him perfectly clear, interpret that for us. In verse 18, it says, "Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God." Now the Jews understood perfectly what the Lord Jesus was saying. They understood that he was claiming to be God. The ones who lived in the day that he lived, who spoke the language that he spoke, who knew exactly what he was saying, understood him to be making himself equal with God. Some say the Lord Jesus never claimed to be God. Oh, the Jews understood that he did. They took up stones to stone him and to try to kill him for his claim of deity. Have you recognized who the Lord Jesus is? Now, you might deny who he is, but you can't deny the fact that the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ claimed to be God. Have you recognized him as such? Let's take a moment and summarize some of the things that we have learned today from this fifth chapter of the Gospel of John. We see the Lord Jesus as he heals a man who had an infirmity for 38 years. This infirmity that this man had not only pictures the spiritual state of man being without strength because he is without God, it also pictures to us the state of the nation of Israel. Remember, it was 38 years they wandered in the wilderness because of their rejection of the Word of God and murmuring against the Lord. We see also that the Lord Jesus has the power and the ability to make a person whole, to make one saved, which is the same meaning of the word being made whole, soundness, salvation in the spiritual sense, the deliverance from sin and the empowering of the new life which Christ gives to all who believe in Him. We see also that the Jews, when confronted with the miracle that the Lord Jesus had performed, they didn't try to deny it. The thing that made them mad was that He had done it on the Sabbath day. He had broken their ritual and tradition, their interpretation of the Sabbath. And when they confront the Lord Jesus, He says in no uncertain terms, that is, terms that were understood by those of His day, that He was God. Now, He didn't say, "I'm God." He said that He worked and His Father worked too. And the way that He declared that God was His Father, the Jews understood. In other words, they interpreted perfectly the meaning of what He said, because it says they sought to kill Him because He made Himself equal with God. So we see the Lord Jesus here, omnipotent, powerful, and claiming deity for Himself. Have you recognized who Jesus Christ is? This is an all-important question, one that you cannot evade. You may attempt not to answer the question in this life, but there will come a day when you will stand before Him and see Him for who He is, the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Won't you submit yourself to Him today? Remember the question the Lord Jesus asked, "Wilt thou be made whole?" A probing question as He sought to stir up the desire and need of this man's heart and life. Do you want to be made whole? What's plaguing your life that you need deliverance from? Turn to the Lord Jesus today. Believe on Him. Receive Him as your Savior. Commit your life to Him as your Lord, and find spiritual wholeness and salvation that comes in Him.